Thank you very much for the kind introduction. I should say at the outset that although we sit next to each other often and appear in many of the same places, Ron and I are not related to each other. We've established this. We've gone back and had the DNA checked, and it's really true. But nevertheless, we have forged a strong friendship over time. Ralph is a former colleague of mine at NRDC, and I think aside from the fact that that establishes our credentials, it does also go to show that, as Maxine said, there's been a certain amount of durability in the area of California energy and environmental policy. So I'll just take a few minutes to give perhaps a slightly parallel but different version of history from where I've seen it in terms of California climate policy, and offer a few thoughts about why and how it is that California has been able to be a leader on this topic. In my case, I would have to refer you back to 50 years ago, which was the time of the founding of the California Air Resources Board. And although ARB wasn't slated at that time to be a leader in environmental policy, and nobody was talking about climate at that point, what has happened over that course of 50 years, which in many respects is lightning fast when it comes to policy changes, has been the ascendancy of the climate issue. And the fact that because the Air Resources Board had established a successful track record of dealing with emissions from power plants and from vehicles and fuels, it was a natural, logical home for the regulatory authority when the legislature decided that they wanted to have California tackle climate change. So ARB didn't invent this topic by any means, but we were there. There had a lot of work had already been done, but there was work that had been done at the Energy Commission. There was work that had been done at the PUC. There were other agencies, including the Natural Resources Agency, which had done a lot of work on adaptation and relationship of climate change to fires and loss of habitat. But when they decided that they actually wanted to set a target and to take regulatory action to achieve that target, ARB was the designated head of that program. And the result of that has been, I think, an amazing opportunity for California to build on not only what we've been doing in this area, but also to forge bonds, in particular with parts of the world where air pollution is emerging as a critical health and public policy issue, including China, of course, but also India and even Europe, which certainly has a long history of dealing with urban air pollution, but has only recently begun to come to terms with the fact that they can't keep burning the kinds of fuels that they've been burning, and that they can't have their cities grow the way that they have grown. So why California a leader on climate policy? Well, first of all, because we recognized the impacts that climate change was going to have earlier than most, just as we saw smog earlier than most people did. And our academic institutions helped with that. The first real public awareness, I would say, where there began to be a lot of talk in the mainstream press about what climate change was going to do to California, actually arose out of work that was done at Scripps and was looking at water, not water quality, but water delivery systems in the state of California, even before we were experiencing the kinds of extreme droughts and flooding that we see today. We were aware of the fact, and the research certainly in large part helped with that, showing that the changes in relatively small changes in mean temperatures were going to lead to a situation where our existing water delivery system, which is highly dependent on expensive infrastructure to capture water in the north and deliver it to the south, was not well adapted to what the climate was actually going to be like. And we were going to be experiencing periods of time where we couldn't get the water to where it needed to be, and or where water was going to be falling in places that couldn't use it, and therefore having to be dealt with as a problem instead of managed as a public resource. And the Energy Commission took that cause up and did further research on that topic, leading to the establishment of a voluntary registry for greenhouse gases by the state legislature, another policy innovation that I don't think anybody's ever tried anywhere else before, which was the legislature actually, by law, established a nonprofit entity and then gave the state agencies the requirement to initially help get it off the ground, but then spun it off into the ether, where, as the California Climate Action Registry, it continues to operate to this day as a private, not-for-profit entity serving all the states and others by establishing protocols for measuring and assessing emissions of greenhouse gases. Purely voluntary, it has no authority to regulate or require emissions reductions, but businesses or local governments that wanted to show that they were doing something had to come there to get a stamp of approval for their emissions reductions if they wanted to be credited by other people. So another sort of policy, a policy innovation for California. We have been at the business of regulating vehicles and fuels for a long time, for 50 years and more. And probably the biggest moment for California in terms of having our influence really be recognized was when President Obama came into office and not only halted litigation that was being pursued by the Bush administration to prevent California from implementing greenhouse gas emission standards for new motor vehicles, but actually decided to embrace the cause and to put the federal government behind the idea that new cars, in addition to meeting fuel economy, safety, and other standards, should have to meet greenhouse gas standards. That regulation, which was put into effect in 2012, was intended to work through 2025 with a midpoint review. The Obama administration completed the technical review and made a finding before they left office that these standards were feasible and, in fact, could be stricter. But the new administration decided to review that finding, and they're in the process now of doing another review, which at least initially they signaled would be used as a way to weaken the standards or delay them. So there's a lot of history here, but I think the common thread, or at least an important common thread, is the willingness of California to be a leader, to move out ahead of other entities, or of being pushed or required by anybody else, simply because we saw the problem and thought that we should do something about it and that we could do something about it. It doesn't mean that we've done everything that one could do or that we've done everything perfectly, because that would not be true. But it is true that we've been willing to be pioneers and to experiment with policies which other people would not have felt that they had the political ability to do. We've been fortunate that we had a lot of public support for what we've done, because people in California tend to just believe, regardless of their political affiliation, that we can have clean air and clean water and still have a prosperous economy. They simply take that as their right, perhaps. And that may be not completely realistic in the minds of some, but the fact is that they believe it, and therefore they're willing to act on it and to take measures that include things like paying a little bit more for gasoline or paying a little bit more for a new car, which repeatedly we were told was going to, you know, make sure that the market would be destroyed or hurt, and just didn't turn out to be true. So that kind of leadership at the national level has now morphed really into an international role for California. And of course, it's been enhanced by the fact that we had a movie star, bodybuilder, international celebrity as governor at the time when our first climate law was passed, who was more than happy to jump into the role of proponent in chief for action on climate change, and who didn't have any problem with issuing executive orders saying, you will reduce emissions, you will have a million solar roofs, and just, everybody else's job was to make it so. But he knew what he was doing. He had both the will and also the shrewdness to surround himself with people who actually knew what technology could do and didn't just make this stuff up out of whole cloth. And then he, of course, was succeeded by Jerry Brown, the once and then again governor of California, who has a long history of interest and involvement in energy policy, a tremendous interest in science and technology, and was willing to knit those things together. So that's really the short version of the story of California's climate leadership. And sometimes people ask me whether an election couldn't change all of that. There will be an election. I know it seems impossible to believe, but Jerry Brown won't be governor. He's not running again because he can't. And so beginning in January of 2019, we will have another governor. But I see no signs of any flagging of interest in continuing to work on these topics. So that's it for now. I'll be happy to answer questions later. Thanks.